about 313 young men to San Jose World Championships in these plants with Brandi Swicegood.
Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. You'll hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in it for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
It's not easy at all.
made me really prioritize and try to be more productive in the moment. So, the job I have, the research I've had, the project I've done in our personal team, one of the best things that I've ever made, special. And I also have a few partners in here that make up for projects that are made for, and I have really healthy ways of all of them. So it helps me a lot that I'm actually making work that I feel meaningful. And my boss is super understanding about my priority in training and everything I have my level of priority. So the attitude is if it's not done, so, I really focus on getting as much done as I can, not to have a lot of work, which is about 20 or maybe 25 hours a week. And then, my daughter is not as far as 5 months a week. So, yeah.
Is that a daughter?
No, she's a pre-K. She's only 3, so she's going 5 days a week. And then a couple of days, she has a little burp after school program, so she can learn to be a little artist. That's been helpful, and I think at first I felt super guilty about putting her in school 5 days a week, and, you know, because I started this whole journey with the idea that I would be able to spend more time with her, but I think actually it's really fun for her to spend more time with a little bit of her age, and in an environment where she's completely engaged in what she's doing all the time, and doing things that she loves. So, I'm trying to look at it as a thing, but a good thing for both of us. And it also means that when I'm with her, I try my best to put aside everything else and just focus on writing books and painting with our hands. Exactly, being with her and enjoying that time.
So, all the fun stuff with training, fun stuff with all the life. Great job, all that. But when are there confidence going into meetings? Did you want to check off any certain boxes knowing that this is going to be a very technical bypass of ability and downhill? And you also know that downhill you might not be able to get nutrition in because your hands may have been handlebars. You don't want to go off the cliff or into rocks. Did you know anything like that? Did you have a plan on how to execute this nutrition plan? What's that look like?
So, Coach Brandi and I talked about beforehand how we would tackle the climb and the descent, knowing how technical the descent was and how hard the climb was. And so, we thought it would be a good idea for me to have first-hand sort of experience that I would be comfortable. So we got to race on Tuesday before the race. That night I put together my race because my friends were going to do my bike for me while I swam. On Tuesday I rode the entire course. So then I knew how to gauge my effort coming up because only a couple of hours, at least the first 20 miles are up. 20 miles of climbing, but it's broken kind of into two. It's broken into two climbs. So the first bit of the climb was punchy kind of hours, like super steep. And then the second part of the climb was like 9K, just steady climbing all the way to the top. And so now, you know, I'm saying the first part, like it's my heart, everything I'm wearing, and that's okay because I'm going to get a little bit of a flat and then it's into my grinding. So I said no ahead of time what that looked like. And then the descent was actually what I was most concerned about going into the race because I knew so many very technical. So on the first day I practiced the descent and I was like, well, I was like not going to hold my hands hard at the time because not only is it broke order, but switch accent and charters and white orders, but there were also a ton of those speed bumps. And we were going 25-30 miles per hour around these hills, this descent, and all of a sudden there's two speed runs, like four or five speed runs in a row. So you have to really pay attention. So then it was good for me. I was a little worried actually. Like, I was like, how am I going to transition in? Just me in a row the whole time. So like, I was kind of doing a couple of sections. The descent, so I knew I could get some nutrition in. And then Thursday, a bunch of my Suunto teammates came into town, came into me, so we had to rent a van and drove to the top of the mud, and then this rode the descent. And I was shocked how much work I was doing that second day, that second time, knowing what was ahead of me, and also being able to watch the lines of some of my teammates in front of me.
Before we left, and he was working on it for
there was an express service here in Austin. He had to pay a lot of money, but I know my dad.
Gosh.
Yeah. It was always like some little thing. And I think that's what you have to really. Since like our first trip to Europe for a race, but like we've traveled to Mexico a bunch of times for races and traveled other places as well. For races, I think one thing that I've process. You keep trying it. You have to do your best to plan as much as you can. Right? Also, can't be married to those plans. There's something that comes up that you just cannot foresee or have any idea. So, have to be like plan, but also be really flexible and not let yourself get mentally worked up if something goes not according to plan. So, I mean, for us, fortunately, like, we had some room, but that's what you told our moms to hurt your parents look like that, and we actually got your B&B. You know, like, I don't intend to learn that I really close to the race.
The question here is, it's like, the lodging was abundant, and it was Airbnb, really close to transition for most people who were trying to figure out how else. And it was super cheap.
Yeah, it was way cheaper than a hotel. Way cheaper and more spacious. Like, we were able to get a two-bedroom apartment, which was perfect for the four of us, and had a little kitchen so we could cook and run across the street in the grocery store. And, you know, that part was super easy and ready. And we actually only rented a car one day while we were there. We didn't need a car because everything was close enough to walk. So, yeah, I mean, logistically, it was.
Okay. So, let's talk about the fun side of the race. You've been in the past as far as athlete check-in and bike check-in. How was the logistics of the split transition to top of things off? Was all this run, well, pretty well, pretty smoothly, or was there an issue? What's all this like? Because it also rained on the sprint, right?
It did rain a little bit on check-in day, yeah. Yeah, we got rained on walking home and dropping off all my stuff. So, yeah, I didn't even remember that until you mentioned it. I mean, I think it was pretty straightforward. Like, it wasn't. I mean, it's pretty typical of any other two transition race. Like, when I got part where you're back at one place, issue with a really clean transition, so you have to put all of your gear in your bag that you didn't have access to this morning beforehand. So it's only your helmet and your shoes in the bike bag. You know, and shoes in that bike bag, and then nothing on your bike, and then you don't have anything like on the ground or on the bike that you this morning. And then I searched for this term, was only to try to find some good feet. And since then, I don't know if I'll ever start working on it, like, if I'll ever get the pay of it, really, but drafting the swim to save some of my effort for the bike. So my plan was to find some good feet for as long as I could, and save some of my effort for the bike. And then the plan for the bike was really to hit the climate board, because I knew that I would have to move out of a descending current to one of the lifts of the bike. And then the run was to go fairly conservative to start, and then build into it and finish the last 5KR, which is sort of a typical plan. And so usually, and I usually go by heart rate rather than pace on the run, particularly on the bike. I was looking to hit around 200 watts on the climb.
Okay. Now, the day beforehand, well, even when you're eating the day before, it's a lot. It's funny, you can just put everything in, and I would have believed it.
Well, so because I had done that whole climb on Wednesday, and also run for about 2 hours on Thursday, then I had a swim back run, well, actually just a swim run shakeout on Friday. I still needed a lot of calories. And I always try on the days leading up to a race and the week before to just amp up the amount of carbs I'm taking in. Not like carb load, but just consciously increase it a little bit so that I sort of get used to that. And so that I have a little bit of like stores. So, on the day before the race, I was really, I knew that I needed a lot of carbs. So, yeah, I just pretty much ate everything that I could find. We were doing a lot of walking around also because where we stayed was like almost a mile away from the race site, and we didn't have a car, so we were walking to dinner, walking to lunch, walking everywhere. I think I don't even remember everything that I wrote down when I told you.
You probably took croissant, you know, marginally toast, you know, or fries, chicken, sweet potatoes, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, so I was super, I didn't end up eating lunch until kind of late. And so I decided that would be sort of my bigger meal for the day. And I went to this amazing burger place that was about a mile from Transition. And the burgers were so huge that they actually didn't like a seat that they gave you black rubber gloves to eat them.
What?
Yeah, that was awesome. It was amazing, and not something I would typically do the day before a race, but I actually have a year ago, so I went to the total burger, but I ate a lot of those fries, and yeah, it was awesome. Yeah, for dinner, we just, because we wanted to, we've been running around all day. I kind of slept in, so I did my workout, my swim and run a little bit later. And then we were dropped with chicken. It seems like 5 o'clock before we got back, right from what we were doing. So I just wanted to chill at home. So that morning, actually, I had a rotisserie chicken and egg and some sweet potatoes and some salad at the grocery store. So that we could just like chill behind the water and make dinner at home. And I had a little time on the line and just relaxed.
I
think that helps. Just like,
as far as the race itself, you get started looking home as I know myself. You go to bed, plan for the race, you wake up. Then already, you got an idea of your single kill and all your single stuff. Yeah, it's a basically legal race for the a white super hangover. Right, supers, but not the
pros.
The pros, which is unique because you're a pro now, but we're again, and now you're like, well, should I wear it or not? So you're going to have questions, but you're going to answer the list, and you're like,
oh, yeah, I got it. If you can't wear what's you can't wear what's you. And also, I just got a new loser in me. Reaction and seamless test, so I was excited to try it out in the race situation. As I didn't have a seamless going into this race, but I knew that the water was going to be pretty warm and like right on the edge of being wet and people. So I actually found a pretty good download of the 17 on one site and got a seamless wet suit for like $80. Really, really good. When I first got it, I looked at it, I was like, did I wear this wrong? Because it looked like it was made for like a 12-year-old boy. It was so tiny. And of course, I was super tight. So I ended up without like maybe 2 weeks or maybe something like that. So I swam in it like every day and really tried to stretch it out and make sure I felt comfortable in it. And I even spent a little bit of time looking around my house in it just to like stretch it out and make sure that I was comfortable with it. Say, and I ended up working out perfectly. But I also brought my sort of skin suit just in case it wasn't that's to go. So I was prepped to go either way.
Okay. So, as far as being over the transition, is that far from where you stayed? You were transition. What's the atmosphere like? In transition at the race versus when the race is down the past, there's still some transition. What's the atmosphere there like?
I just had different tones. Like, I didn't feel, so if, you know, when you go to, I guess it's always, it was like the Boston Marathon for me, and that, like, when you go to another marathon, another 70.3, there are people of all different experience levels there. And so you feel all different kind of nerves, all different kind of jangles in the air. In this case, it was just a little bit more serious. Everybody kind of knew what they were doing. There wasn't a lot of, like, messing around or people looking around lost or that kind of anxiety. It was more like the anxiety of, I'm going to kill this, you know. So I think that was the environment. Like, I'm really super stoked, like, excited to be there. And very, not so serious.
So, you get out of transition. You might not be assigned your wheels here. You get your nutrition plan on. You use some ampies and ways to stop. How do you like those wheels? Pretty good.
Okay.
So, you get down to the start area, you see yourself in your age group, which is almost at the no?
We just reached out to the pros.
Oh, okay. This mixed up. So, your first of the pros, so the pros go off and you're standing around where you're going to be in the vision versus in the back where you're going to be. What is the thoughts going on in your mind right before the start of the win pros? Because that's where you're going to be in the future.
Yeah. To be honest, I was trying not to think about that too much because I wanted to be in the moment where I was right now. And I also, there's a girl in my age group who's from Austin who connected with each other and we saw each other at the race. And so we were just kind of chatting about and talking in plans and, you know, training going into the race and captions and stuff like that. So it was exciting to be there and to sort of watch the pros. But I was trying to not let it get into my nerves. I let myself get too worked up. And just kind of enjoy being there where I was at that moment. It was really awesome to, like, hear them call out from the way. Lucy Charles, and we've actually seen Lucy Charles from what years growing up in the start to just being in that environment where all these amazing girls, you know, we see on TV generally, or that are really seen on TV, they're right there, which was really cool.
You gave us a chance to go for you. You got a 35 minutes and 37 seconds here. I know these rocks are not something pleasant to walk on, but they don't last very long because they drop off.
Yeah, the way they did the time I was starting was 10 rolls into the water every 10 seconds. And so it was kind of watching the purple walker, the purple walker, like 7 miles in a car before I see what they had my hand on it. Watching them, I just decided, like, this too is my kind of get, like, my knees in the water. I was going to start swimming because I didn't know what I needed on the rocks. So, yeah, I started. I only remember a few steps on the rocks, and then I just jumped in and started swimming because I didn't want to lose my footing. And so, yeah, I just started swimming as soon as possible. And I tried to put a hard time on the feet. I don't know if other people experience this, but I feel like the self-seating system, like people grouping themselves by the amount of time they think they're going to swim in, is kind of a joke.
Okay. yank his leg.
My one suit was stuck around my ankles, and he ended up having to, like, get another volunteer, and they're both dragging me, and we're all just, like, laughing hysterically. But this is too, like, dragging this tiny girl around the transition. I'm like, okay, mom. And then I ran and got my bike, but yeah.
So, you get out of the bike right ahead. How did the first few miles go before you hit the heels?
I'm like, well, it's fine, you know, just like getting your senses about you, letting your heart, letting everybody know about it better. I was trying to get in some water and some nutrition. And now I was working on the ground starter. So, because I knew at least for that first part of the climb, that first quarter, that would be too much and too steep. Yeah. So I can't understand that maybe less than 10 miles of that going back to transition, and you have to go around all these roundabouts. So the last roundabout, right, it was sort of confusing because you could go two ways coming out of it, and the volunteers at that roundabout were sort of paying any attention to what was going on, and so there was no one there to sort of correct me coming out of it. So I picked the way that seemed So I found this road, and there was a fortunately there was a volunteer at the end of that road who was like hollering and screaming at me and waiting for me to turn around. I was like, turn around. And I got across and I probably only lost like 30 or 45 seconds. And that was
if you look at the times that have all the other females in this race, this is actually a respectable time here because there's only a handful of folks that went under three.
Yeah, I feel pretty good about it. My favorite.
Yeah.
And I felt like it was a good expression of mindfulness. We worked a lot and really hard.
So, you get a T2 less than 3 minutes and then you're out of the run, and you end up running almost 8 minute mile pace exactly. I think it's pretty close to exactly 8 minute mile pace here. How do you feel about this? I know it's pretty flat. You did some strength training with your run. How does the run go?
It's pretty good. For me, I think maybe we probably talked about this before. I mean, the run is the place where I feel like I still have a lot of work to do, and it's for me like the slowest bit of progress that I've made. Like, I've made a huge progress, I think, in all three disciplines, but the least in the run. And I think with the role of the day, like, had I run the same course in the IRONMAN, I probably would have run the 30s. My time in Cozumel, I think, like, last year, and that's a much easier night course than I'm ready. So, I have to know in my own head that this is a pretty big improvement for me, even though there is still much room for improvement for me to come. I am also pretty pleased with my execution. I started out I had a strange pain in my right foot. Like, it was kind of asleep and pins and needles and kind of achy. And so for the first few miles, I was trying to work my way through that, and it eventually went away. I'm still not sure what caused it, so that's fair. But eventually went away, and I started to feel pretty strong going around, and then the last few miles, I decided, as we talked about when I talked about with Brandi, to really put the pedal to the metal for the last 5K, and that was my fastest part of the race, my fastest part of the run, so I was pleased with that. The frustrating part for me was not having that heart rate data, because, as I said before, that for me is really how I manage my own and what are my effort as well. I think for me, the lesson there is I need to probably practice more those pieces with that right, so that I'm not so reliant on the top race day.
Right. Are you able to use the race base heart rate?
Just for me, that wasn't working either. So what happened was I didn't have anything for most of the bike ride. Then it said that I had even though it was tiny numbers, I knew they weren't right.
So, as far as the run course goes, maybe some advice that you give somebody that hasn't done this course before for the run and the bike?
So, for the run, I think make sure you use every aid station because it does, even though and then something that I learned that I never experienced in a race before, they had this salty water, mineral water on the course. And I started out with a lot of tummy discomfort, and I just drank some of that mineral water, and for that was pretty cool. So, yeah, tummy troubles, mineral water, it helped. And 10 minutes, the only thing for me is that knowing your head that first loop is going to be more aware than the second loop. Because for me, that was a little bit disorienting. I expected I would be turning around while I watched it 5K, and we weren't. But yeah, that run is really straightforward. There are not a lot of turns, you just and there's not a lot of shade, so make sure you get ice and hydrate well. On a course like that where you're doing a lot of climbing, a lot of descending, I think you can push harder on the climbs than you would in a rolling course. So, because you have, with that one descent, so much time to let your heart rate and your legs recover. So, my advice would be to be afraid to push hard on those hills because you do have a lot of recovery time.
So, I would say that you feel like you looked a little bit more stable on this,
I think I probably left a little bit.
Okay. Yeah. And so, we need to talk about the set they use for this bike ride. Are you familiar with what gears you use on that bike?
Yes. It's a 30-inch.
Okay.
And 5211.
Okay, cool. Let's see here. So, what was it like finishing the Ironman State Bike World Championship here?
It's really emotional. I think that for me was when it kind of hit home that this is my last race as an amateur. Because I really did. I gave it everything I had in those last couple of miles from my run. And I came across the finish line and collapsed and started sobbing and all of those things. And I it just feels so emotional because I only was at the end of this magnificent race. Such a beautiful course and so challenging. But also, the end of this sort of stage of my career, what better way is to finish it than on this particular day? And what made it really emotional for me, too, was my mom was there to see it. My daughter was there, so I got to see both of them on the course. And my husband as well, right there cheering and taking photos and just watching him being with pride and seeing how happy my mom and my little girl were out there. It was I just couldn't think of a better way to complete this day and this part of my career.
So, after you finish this race, you know, race the next day, go stand around for that, or get up and go somewhere else. What's all this like?
I sat down and watched a little bit of the race, a little bit of the run, and I spent not training at the expo, helping the Suunto of us. Suunto and IRONMAN, if he's doing it, a really cool watch. And then it's like my training world championships, and IRONMAN, and then Suunto watch. In addition, so that's helping teach people how to watch it.
So, all the fun stuff that happened in this race, it's a big change, it's a transitioning race for you. What is something you really learned about yourself through an experience in this race? Because this is a monumental race for you, because it marks the end of one time of your life and the beginning of a new one. This next month, you race at an event only 3 weeks ago as a professional. What is something you learned about yourself through this experience?
Challenge for me was, I'm going to tell you this story. So, my husband is extremely sweet and believes me more than you possibly imagine. And absolutely not under that. So, you know, we've been having, we talk through things on the phone. He drove the course today, whatever. So he's some of the sweetest men. There's not this conversation. He said, totally seriously. So I just want you to be surprised if you come in first off the bike and there's no one else there. And, you know, don't let that freak you out. And watching me, and that she's going to be proud of me, and I'm going to have a story to tell to her at the end of this day about what I accomplished and how proud I am of her. And so, on race day, when I came off the bike, Travis, my husband, was first on the run, and I started to run. And as I moved to, I asked him to tell me where I was, and he told me I was at 20. Push myself to give it my best when I knew there was really no realistic chance for me to be able to perform him. And I think that would be huge for me as I start my professional career, knowing that I have some less goals ahead of me. And so it forced me to think about why I am racing. I want to tell her that I I decided to call it in, but I was only an hour earlier. Now, no, that's not what I am. That's not Congress, and I want her to be out there. And so, I was just having this moment. I was going to go ahead and just tap my thoughts to myself. Every minute, basically, am I doing my best? Am I doing my best? And I felt like at the end of the day, I really did. I had a strong performance. And I was proud of what I accomplished at the end of the
day. So you suggest that your recovery process was like all that fun stuff, but I mean, you have like out of here in 6 weeks. So get back to training.
Yeah, and then I have a band as well. 2 weeks.
Oh, so you're just doing it. I mean, more and more races now. Okay. So, how is this training going on over this next week out from motivations and whatever you're doing now? So, you've had time to recover a little bit. You've had time to get back into the groove in Texas. You're obviously training your way up and getting all your stuff on the ground. What's this training been like for you?
Well, we spent here in France and hadn't been there before. We used the opportunity to take a week and a week of vacation and spend time traveling in the French Riviera for about a week after the race.
So, you don't have to pay all the touristy places, do
you? We didn't pay us. We went to Monaco, we went to Cannes, we went to just all the little beach towns on the French Riviera and stayed in that area. And I went for a nice bike ride along the coast one day into a little swimming with this amazing pool, double pool that we had in Monaco. It was like unreal beautiful. We had lots of cliffs and you could look out and see the yachts, and the water was like as salty as the sea. And it was just unreal pretty. And we drank a lot of wine and ate a lot of cheese and a bunch of croissants, so yeah, that recovery was awesome. And then, so we just got back over the weekend, we got back Saturday, and that travel was rough.
It's easy to feel like, but
so it took a little time, so this week I've just been kind of easing back into things, so, I train every day, but just easy stuff. And today I had a 3K swim, just pulling, but nothing hard, like nothing kind of stuff hard. And then an hour and a half bike ride, all just easy. And then I think next week we'll start rolling into a little bit more, so I'm going to be ready for where we go. And then, because of my luck for that, and that'll be my last race of the season.
Yeah. So, to wrap everything up here, do you have some sponges that you'll make sure when you die?
Yeah, for sure. Suunto clothing watches. Most accurate, best battery life. Nuun, which for me has been the best hydration system that I have tried over my time racing. Good flavor, it's easy on the tummy, all that stuff.
Secondary to the mindset.
1,000%.
Oh, my.
your fitness can't show up if your brain doesn't.
So would you say it's I like that red idea. So would you say it would be easy for your entire race to be sabotaged by a random thought of anger or outburst of emotion or someone close to you saying something negative to you?
I would say that your response to those things that happen to around you or happen to you, your ability to deal with those mentally absolutely determines what will happen with your race far more than the training that you put in leading into race day. So if you weigh on yourself mentally,
thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.